So here for another episode of Telly Talk, and it's a New Year special. I'm joined here today with Millie Payne as well. And we've gone for the Christmas listings, but now we're going to do the New Year. So a lot of TV to watch, which is what most people could be doing over the Christmas period, right, and New Year.
I think so. I think it's definitely a time when, although it's family get together and you spend quality time, the telly always just seems to be on in the background.
Yeah.
And who knows what the new year is going to bring, but I'm excited. I'm excited for the new series that are coming out for sure.
Yeah, it's a bit like work. I mean, do you treat it as work when you're watching A Crown? I do. It's kind of, I study it, take notes.
Yeah, I must admit, for my media A-level, it really drilled me into analysing the shots that were used and all what could be the underlying, like, underlying meaning with that. So I think I definitely read more into telly than I used to.
And of course, The Crown's real, as we know. I know there's been a lot of debate about it, but it's based on real events. I guess the royal family is trying to say that it's not based on real events, but I think it's at least based on like historical developments. Is that right? I mean, how do you read the Crown? Because there's been this big debate. The culture secretary Oliver Dowden said that, you know, it should have a kind of a disclaimer at the front, maybe saying that it's partly fiction or all fiction.
What I struggle with is this is the fourth season of it now. Why wasn't this said before? So I think they want to say that although the series is based on real events, not all of it is true. But to me, that's very strange to just introduce that for the fourth season. Why would that not have been disclaimed from season one? And I think as I read this article, the main issue they have with it is the portrayal of Prince Charles, how they've made him out to be quite heartless and maybe quite distant and like unattached from family and things like that. But to me, if this series has been going on, this is obviously the fourth season now, why would there not be this claim from the beginning? That's what I don't get.
Maybe because they're all friends getting trashed like day in, day out through the different, particularly through series four. I mean, Charles doesn't come out of it too well with Diana, does he? And, we were just having this big debate off stage, weren't we?
That,
Diana's always going to win that battle about who wins the hearts and minds of the general public. She always did, didn't she?
Without a doubt. I think she always, always will win over him. I mean, I know it's not the be all and end all, but social media, when The Crown for the latest season came out, Diana is, I've never seen negative comments about Diana on my socials. I think so many pictures have been shared of her since this series aired. So I think Charles, no matter how the producers decided to portray him, I still think the public and the people watching are still always going to be Team Diana. I don't think any portrayal would change that.
Yeah, and 2021 then, is there going to be more episodes of the Crown release? When do they release them on Netflix?
Well, I think they've said that they're going to go up to the early 2000s, which would take it up to season six. Obviously, who knows with the current restrictions whether they'll be able to film the next season that early on. I'm not sure. Maybe it'll be, hopefully, towards the end of next year. That's me being hopeful.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'm pretty sure they're only doing up to the early 2000s in terms of the history and then stopping. But to me, why would you not carry on? But that's
no, I think they're going to, I would have thought they'd be carrying on.
Yeah.
Getting Harry and Meghan as well. So,
that's what I thought.
And there's speculation. I mean, this is what my wife was saying anyway, that Harry and Meghan, do you think they'll actually appear as their own characters in The Crown?
I'm unsure. The fact that they've tried to distance themselves from the royal family in real life, whether they'd want to be in the TV show, I'm not too sure. But it depends on whether the producers decide to take it that far. It might get to, obviously this season has caused a lot of stir. So whether they will try to keep things as simple as possible and not bring in anything too controversial.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see, I think.
Yeah. Also for 2021 then, we can just stick to Netflix for now. Sex Education, what's that all about?
So the third season's coming of that in January. And I must admit, I won't give away any spoilers for those that might want to go and watch the first two seasons. It just covers such a wide range of people, and I think they talk about quite topical issues but make it humorous, and I think that is probably what is quite appealing about it. But without giving anything away, there's a character that that is disabled, and I think a lot of producers who bring you naturally feel that sense of sympathy or empathy towards them. This disabled character in the show is absolutely hated, and I think that's something quite controversial because you wouldn't expect it. They cover a lot of issues like sexual harassment and people trying to discover who they really are. So I think it's very topical, but they do it in a very humorous way. And Gillian Anderson stars in it, who I think she's great. But I know that Twitter erupted when the news was leaked that the third season's coming back. So yeah, I'm excited for it.
Yeah. Back onto terrestrial TV then. Line of Duty. I've only seen one or two episodes, and that's on BBC One, isn't it? I mean, that's been a long-running series. Where are we at on the series front with that?
So this will be season six.
Right.
I binge-watched all of them throughout the first lockdown, and it is just incredible. The stories that they come up with, because obviously they're trying to find out whether other police officers are corrupt or not. And I must admit, the different emotions you feel towards certain characters is just mad. I mean, both my mum and dad watched it before I did. And when I had it on, they'd always end up coming and watching it with me. They said it's just one of those series that just hooks you. But I've seen throughout, I think it was maybe leading up to this lockdown, they were all making TikToks of them, like the characters dancing in the studio. And I think that's got people really excited for the new series, especially with the current circumstances, meaning that a lot of shows have been pushed back. But this has definitely been confirmed that it should be on our screens before March 2021.
Yeah, the Pembrokeshire murders then, so that's an ITV series, isn't it? Mini-series.
Yeah.
That was one that has been pushed back. That's based on real life, isn't it?
Based on real events. So based on, I think his name's John Cooper. He was a Welsh serial killer. And that was meant to be filmed... Well, I'm assuming it's being filmed now, ready for release next year.
Yeah.
And I think it's been classed as a mini series, so it'll be, I think, in three parts. But yeah, I think there's something about, I don't know what it is. I really enjoy serial killer documentaries.
Yeah.
So I think I might be giving that one a watch because I think that will be quite dark, maybe not an uplifting one, but.
And ITV have done well, haven't they, on the series front this year? I know that they looked at the Bamber murders, and that was a really good series, mini-series. Jeremy Bamber, obviously still in prison for the murdering his family. That was a really good series, and they've done well on that. I mean, BBC, they've done well on some of these political dramas. I know we looked at recently Roadkill. So, the terrestrial TV channels can still come up with some good dramas, even on smaller budgets than, like,
definitely,
for example, that you get with Netflix.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that. I think, like you said, ITV definitely do well with these, maybe some the more darker series. But then you do have BBC, who look at their political thrillers, their psychological thrillers. I think as well, perhaps the current situation means that they've got more time to think about new ideas and new stories, because obviously a lot of filming's been resumed, so maybe that gives the screenwriters more time to think of new content. But I must admit, I do enjoy a psychological thriller that I think BBC do really well with. I think there's a new one coming out next year called Vigil with Saran Jones and Martin Compston, who's in Line of Duty. I don't know how much it will be my cup of tea, but I think it's to do with the Navy and the British security services, and Saran Jones gets involved in that. So yeah, we'll have to see.
Yeah, Conversations with Friends. So what's all that about? That's on the BBC as well.
Yes.
Lots of new programmes. I mean, are these things that have been put back, do you think? I mean, Conversations with Friends, is that an ongoing series, or I've not heard of it before?
So it's based on a book by the author who wrote Normal People, which aired, I think it was through the peak of the first lockdown.
Yeah.
And it was set in Ireland, and I must admit, from my perspective, the actors and actresses weren't that well known, but I think that's what they're hoping to do with Conversation with Friends, is bring new talent to life. But it'll be on BBC Three, and it looks at, I think it's into romance, and it's very, very much, I think all of her novels are based around romance, but Normal People was so successful. And I think, again, because BBC Three is not a channel anymore, and you have to obviously go
online.
And that was... the situation with Normal People as well. And again, all 12 episodes were there, ready to watch. So I think because of the success of Normal People, there'll be a lot of pressure on this new series because it's by the same author.
Yeah, just before we finish up for the break, This Is Going to Hurt. So that's a book. I know it was by a renowned surgeon. I mean, there's talk of that being made into a comedy. Now, we were just having a conversation off stage about that. I mean, that kind of the issues that are discussed in that book, I wouldn't say they would matter for a comedy series, but
no.
Maybe I'm wrong.
I've not read it personally, but I really want to. I think it's based on the memoirs of a, like you said, of a surgeon. And when I read that it was becoming a comedy, I mean, my friends read it and she said it was really like thought-provoking, emotional. So it's going to be very interesting if they do switch it to a comedy. How will they approach that? Especially if you're dealing with quite challenging yeah. issues. But unless they want something a little bit more lighthearted, if the novel is really quite moving. I'm intrigued to see that one.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. We're going to explore a lot more in the second half of this Christmas New Year special Telly Talk with Millie Payne. So join us for the second half. We'll be covering a lot more of the programmes coming up in 2021. So back here with Telly Talk with Millie Payne, Christmas New Year special. We're going to be looking ahead to 2021 again, as we did in the first half. So the rig, what's all that about? Because I know it's got links to The Bodyguard, which me and my wife saw, and that was really gripping, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, not the first episode. I thought, what's all this about?
Yeah.
Then you get into it, and it was actually very good. Are we going to see the return of The Bodyguard, or are we going to have to just stick with The Rig?
Do you know what? I'm not sure. I can't remember which is probably good because I wouldn't give it away anyway. I can't remember how The Bodyguard ended, but I think, was it a bit on a bit of a cliffhanger?
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that
someone
will return.
Someone got killed, I remember.
Yeah.
Or there was an assassination attempt.
Yeah. I was the same as you. I watched the first episode and I thought, so much is going on. Is my brain going to be able to keep up? But then I thought it was incredible. The Rig is actually an Amazon series, which, unless I'm completely been living under a rock, I didn't know that Amazon created original series. I think this one's being filmed in Scotland, but I think one of the producers has said it's very much a look into nature and the environment and how we survive. So quite different from The Bodyguard. But going back to the actual Bodyguard, I'd love to see that return. And who knows? That's not one that I researched that came up, but hopefully that'd be quite hard to film, I'd imagine, under COVID restrictions.
Yeah, exactly. What about Behind Her Eyes then? What's that about?
This is definitely one that I'll be adding to my list. So a psychological drama thriller and starring Tom Bateman. And basically it's your typical, messed up story. So I think this woman ends up falling in love with her boss or having an affair with her boss. And then in the meantime is becoming really friendly with his wife. So I think that's all I've read in terms of synopsis, but I think that is coming out, that will be coming out next year.
Yeah.
So I really get hooked on those ones, especially where there's probably a lot of different elements within the story and it's, you don't really know what's going to happen. So I'm excited for that one.
Yeah. So what would you like to see made into what's that program you'd like to see for 2021? Do you think, looking back at what you've enjoyed in this year, 2020?
Yeah. Actually, speaking about The Bodyguard, I've just reminded myself how much I love that. I would love to see that come back. I'm trying to think of others. Honestly, The Bodyguard, yeah, you talking about The Bodyguard has made me really think how they could make another series of that. There's been quite a good, I've enjoyed some of the, they came out during the peak of the first lockdown, quite some like Love is Blind on Netflix and these dating shows. I think they were very good and easy to watch throughout lockdown. So whether they'll make second series of this, I mean, Love is Blind was just mad. Like they were building connections behind a wall. So one was one side and then someone proposed. And I'm thinking, how can you do this? And you've not met them, but it was just such bad telly that you sort of couldn't stop watching. So that's something I'd like to see return, because especially through lockdown, it made it more bearable. I think The Bodyguard for definite. And
yeah.
I'd like to see what they're going to do with The Crown as well.
Yeah. Vigil, just a word on Vigil. What's that? That's another BBC series. So the BBC are churning out these kind of these series, aren't they?
Yeah, so that's what I think I briefly touched on in the first part. Yeah. So starring Saran Jones, who's been in Dr. Foster.
Yeah.
That's the only one I can think of from the top of my head. I think she's been in plenty of other things. And Martin Compston, who stars in Line of Duty. And I think it's based on, there's a death on board a nuclear submarine, and Saran Jones is part of the police force. She ends up getting involved with the Navy and the British security services. So I think that'll be quite a different drama than probably what I'm used to watching. But obviously Roadkill, we talked about, wouldn't have been my go-to, and I really enjoyed that.
Yes.
So I'll definitely keep an eye out on that one.
Is it a handmaiden? I've never seen this. Handmaid's Tale. I mean, I've never seen this. A lot of previous colleagues have mm-hmm. seen it. I know it's been going for 2 or 3 years now.
Yeah.
I mean, what is that? Is that that's been going on, hasn't it? So. Just tell us a bit about what it's about, if people haven't seen it.
So, I must admit, I had to do my research on this one because it's one of those I'd heard, like you, a lot of people mention, but it's never really been something that would appeal. I think it's set in, like, it's a dystopian novel that has been adapted for telly. And it's American originally, which is something I didn't know. And I think it's, like, a totalitarian society, and they believe that women belong to the state, and I think it's a society that used to belong to America but doesn't belong to America anymore, and I think it's a lot to do with women and children and things like that. So I don't know if I'd rush to watch it, but it's very, very popular, very popular.
Yeah, it is, yeah. So before we finish up then, we got Netflix, got a $1 billion budget for just UK programming. So they're going to be churning out a lot of stuff. So how do the BBC, ITV, Channel 4, how do they compete then? Or do they not even compete and just do what they're best at, which is kind of, for Channel 4, quite kind of left field program,
yep.
but very watchable. ITV, obviously, kind of celebrity-based programming, and maybe BBC more kind of documentaries, political thrillers, that kind of thing. Should they find their niche nowadays?
I think it's strange because obviously so many people have a Netflix account, but yet I would, for example, if I spoke to my nan and we were talking about The Crown and I said, oh, have you watched it? And she said, oh, no, because you obviously don't have Netflix. So for them, their go-to series will still be the ones on BBC and ITV because they don't have access to Netflix. I mean, they obviously could do, but I've always said, oh, you should get a Netflix account. So I think they will... all these independent companies, I think, will keep doing what they're doing. But when you've got such a massive organisation such as Netflix, obviously pumping in $1 billion to the UK service alone, I think they are going to really have to think about the kind of shows or the ways that they're showing or streaming their shows. Because I think we've spoken about it before, how the BBC are going down this route of putting shows on in one block as opposed to watching weekly. So maybe that's something that ITV will consider doing. But I think, like we've spoken about, they've all got their niche in a way. So we said, obviously ITV is more perhaps the celebrity side and all of this, but it'll be, I think, Netflix... what they'll be capable of. Who knows what we'll be talking about this time in a year.
Yeah, exactly. What about the soaps? I mean, I don't really watch the soaps, but I mean, how are they adapting, do you think, to the kind of new realities of social distancing?
Oh, I think it will be tough. I think I didn't understand. There was a scene, I think there were two characters kissing. I thought, how on earth they filmed that? And I think I had a look, I had a conversation with someone about it, and they said it's obviously very special camera techniques, but you do think how much impact this situation has had, because you think a normal filming situation, you wouldn't have to worry about getting 2 metres within people. I wonder if they'll make a lot of, it'll be interesting to see their Christmas storylines. Do they bring COVID into that? I'll be intrigued to see what goes on there.
Yeah, finish up in Made in Chelsea. I know you're addicted to that. My wife seems to be as well. But I mean, they're dealing with the social distancing thing quite well, aren't they? And you hear a lot of people talking about, sex and all the rest of it, but you don't actually see it, do you?
So
they do kind of make reference to lockdown, don't they? Second lockdown as well.
Yeah.
So they seem to, I mean, they're all in one big bubble, aren't they? Or how's it work?
I think so. I mean, they definitely make reference to it a lot. I think Towie's finished now. Towie also made reference to it, but they've done it slightly differently, where everyone did actually stay 2 metres 2 metres apart. But with Made in Chelsea, I mean, the episode I saw last night, one of the girls, she came into this restaurant and she was talking about her glittery mask and how if you have to wear a mask, you should do it fashionably and things like that. So they do definitely make reference to it. But they don't really seem to adhere to social distancing. So I'm assuming they all are considered each other's bubble. It's quite interesting to see how they've done it differently to Towie. But I wonder if there will be a Made in Chelsea Christmas special, because it is still ongoing at the moment, isn't it?
Yeah, so normally you get this kind of end of season party where they all kind of stagger each other off in the same room. Normally they're slagging each other off, you know, behind each other's back, but then the end of season Christmas party is always a good laugh. You see it actually happen in real life.
I enjoy those episodes a lot.
and a lot of the Made in Chelsea is kind of, it's a bit like The Crown, isn't it? It's kind of based on reality, and some of these scenes are actually, you know, I mean, Sam and his love antics, that's playing out in real life, isn't it? On social media.
Yeah, I think no one probably knows what's going to happen with them, but I do feel sorry for these people that are in the public eye in a way, because they can't really do anything without speculation. I mean, someone clocked that Zara might have been doing her workouts in Sam's garden, and they were like circling parts that matched from Zara's video to Sam's garden. I'm like, oh my god, like, I feel sorry for them, because they're being scrutinized. But I guess that's what you do sign up for, I guess, being part of a reality TV show.
Yeah, exactly. And you're still getting a product placement there as well with the different bars and stuff. I mean, it is very product placement orientated, isn't it? That whole programme that you made in Chelsea. But it is watchable, isn't it?
It is. And I will be excited to watch a Christmas special. I wonder if Towie will do one. It's not that I've seen. Yeah. But I really enjoy those, because there's still loads of drama, even though it's the build-up to Christmas. So, yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah, exactly. So 2021, it looks like it's going to be quite a good season for not just Netflix, but for the BBC and ITV and Channel 4 as well. I mean, we don't really mention much Channel 4, but I go to them for the news. Do you watch much on Channel 4?
I watched, I would go to them for more of their documentaries, which they've sometimes done some really, really good ones. I used to be an avid watcher. I know it's not on anymore, of Embarrassing Bodies. That used to be my favourite Channel 4 programme.
Millie, thanks for coming again today. We're going to be covering a lot of Telly Talk in 2021, so thanks for coming in. And Happy New Year.
And you.
Cheers, thanks. Take care.